Honorable Mr. Justice Randall Wuerl, Central Bank Governors, members of the Board of Directors of the Central Bank of Barbados, distinguished specially invited guests, conference participants, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed an honor and pleasure that on behalf of the management and staff of the Central Bank of Barbados, we welcome you all this evening to this, the 33rd Adlith Brown Memorial Lecture, which is being held during the 50th anniversary of the Annual Monetary Studies Conference. Dr. Adlith Brown, in whose name this series of lectures is dedicated, began her academic journey in 1968, the same year the Regional Program of Monetary Studies was established. Dr. Brown would eventually become the fourth coordinator of this program from 1980 to 1984. I did not know her personally, but there remains an image in my memory of a slender, active lady at my first conference back in 1981. Many complimentary remarks about her contribution to the profession and to this conference have been made by those who truly knew her. And J. Edward Green, then head of social and economic research, at the inaugural lecture noted that she was a passionate regionalist with a quick and bruising intellect and an outstanding economic theorist. As this year marks the golden anniversary of the Annual Monetary Studies Conference, I'm sure that all of you will agree that she would have been justly proud of this momentous achievement. Tonight's lecture will be delivered by the noted Caribbean economist, Dr. Arnold McIntyre. Dr. McIntyre has built up over three decades of regional experience in macroeconomic policy and economic research in small open economies, international trade policy, and the development and regional integration, as well as working with regional institutions, for example, the Caribbean Development Bank, the Organization of the Eastern Caribbean States Secretariat, the Caribbean Export Development Agency, the Caribbean Regional Negotiating Machinery, now called the Office of Trade Negotiations, and the CARICOM Secretariat. He's a member of the staff of the International Monetary Fund and served for a few years as head of the Caribbean Regional Technical Assistance Center, which is headquartered in Barbados. His current post is Deputy Division Chief of the Caribbean Division, Division 1 of the Western Hemisphere Department of the International Monetary Fund. By that, you can see that his training, his exposure, and academic acuity renders him more than adequately qualified to speak with some authority on Caribbean economies. Although, knowing Arnold as I do, he may have been tempted to speak on our shared passion, West Indies cricket. In several of our conversations about economic developments, he often says, after some banter about the economy, okay, now let's discuss what's truly important. Tonight, however, it is the Caribbean economies that take center stage. The focus of tonight's lecture will be on the critical issues and challenges of strengthening economic growth and resilience in the Caribbean. This topic is relevant and timely. Given the subpar performances of many Caribbean economies in the wake of global economic and financial crisis, I'm confident that finding the right mix of solutions to these challenges we face is within our reach, notwithstanding the rigidities imposed on our economies associated with small size, the high degree of openness to external trade and financial shocks, as well as the destructive effects of natural disasters. As you are all aware, Barbados is currently in the process of implementing a homegrown program of renewal and transformation, supported by an extended fund facility arrangement with the IMF. Therefore, I'm sure we'll be listening intently, not only to the nature of the challenges, but also the viable opportunities and solutions that may be pursued to enhance our economic circumstances. In closing, it would be remiss of me if I didn't mention that Sir Alistair McIntyre, a distinguished regional academic, development economist, and statesman in his own right, was the first coordinator of the Regional Program of Monetary Studies. And fate would have it that his son is delivering this distinguished lecture in the 50th year of that groundbreaking program. It appears the stars are aligned for what is expected, stimulating and provocative lecture. Therefore, without further ado, I invite our distinguished speaker, Dr. Arnold McIntyre, to address you.
Governor of the Central Bank of Barbados, Mr. Cleviston Haines, Central Bank Governors of the Caribbean region, specially invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, friends. It is indeed a pleasure and honor to be invited to give the 33rd Adlith Brown Memorial Lecture. It is especially so since it was under the supervision of Professor Compton Brown that I participated in the annual Regional Monetary Studies Conference, cutting my teeth as a young and enthusiastic economist. The Regional Monetary Studies Program, of which Dr. Brown was the first coordinator, has nurtured generations of Caribbean economists and technicians. Several of my colleagues, including at the IMF, Shelton Nichols, Jean Leon, Wendell Samuels, have all been participants of the Regional Monetary Studies Program. I am particularly pleased to be doing it here in Barbados, which in many ways is like my second home. Starting in my early days in 1982, as an undergraduate economist, undergraduate student at UWI Cave Hill, into the early 90s in my early professional career as an economist at the Caribbean Development Bank, and then moving on to the Caribbean regional negotiating machinery. At a personal level, my wife is a Barbadian and my sister lives in Barbados, so I cannot be excused from speaking in Barbados. Ladies and gentlemen, friends, post the global economic crisis that gripped the world almost 10 years ago, a lot of the public discourse on the Caribbean economy has expressed disappointment at economic performance in most of the countries and highlighted the inappropriate policy response to those challenges. Against this background, I warn you, it can be easy to slip into a mood of pessimism. The evidence does indicate that the Caribbean has been slowest in its recovery from the crisis in the Western Hemisphere. So there is a cause for concern. But let me say at the outset that the Caribbean must not lose its confidence, must not become fatalistic in accepting a less than prosperous future. Rather, we need to summon our confidence, instill greater discipline in the management of our economies. Some may say, change completely the paradigm by which we conduct economic management, not only in the design and implementation of policy, but in the institutional arrangements around it. Economic and social policy design and implementation must become more inclusive and more cohesive at the national and regional levels. We live in a moment in time where forward-looking decision-making aimed at achieving transformation and stronger economic development will not necessarily mean immediate economic reward or benefit, but the challenge is we must stay the course. Hence the choice of my topic: how do we achieve stronger sustainable growth while building resilience to minimize the negative impact of devastating natural disasters, increasing climate change impacts, together with global events over which we have no control? Small countries are almost volatile by definition. Shocks are frequent and often, and in the case of natural disasters, devastating. When the economy of Dominica loses 220% of GDP from a natural disaster, you understand what I mean. What has been the Caribbean story? If we look at the chart over there, we will see that the Caribbean story has been quite positive. Since independence in the 1960s and 1970s, the Caribbean countries have registered strong economic and social outcomes. Per capita income has risen and is now in the top 25% of all emerging market developing countries. The median life expectancy is 73 years, compared with 70 for emerging market developing economies. These positive development indicators to which I refer have also come along with a strong democratic tradition of governance. In the presentation tonight, purely for analytical convenience, I propose to separate the Caribbean into two species of economies, two analytical groups, if you will: tourism-intensive economies, Antigua and Barbuda, the Bahamas, Barbados, Dominica, Grenada, Jamaica, St. Kitts and Nevis, St. Lucia, St. Vincent and the Grenadines. And four commodity exporters, Guyana, Suriname and Trinidad and Tobago. What has happened since 2000? What the charts up there indicate is that since 2000, real GDP has lagged in the tourism-intensive economies. I want to first point you to this chart. This chart speaks to convergence. How fast are we converging to the per capita income of the United States or advanced economies? If you start in the 1970s, 1980s, 1990s, you will see that we are converging towards higher living standards and higher per capita income. This, look at the trajectory here and compare it to this year. We begin to slow down around here. And now we are in reversal. And this is the dangerous part. We are losing the development gains that we achieved over 30 years. Since 2000, real GDP growth of Caribbean economies has been about half of that of emerging market developing economies, and about two-thirds that of non-Caribbean small states. By a wider definition of developing countries, we have performed poorly. By a narrower definition of developing countries referring to small states, we have also performed poorly. Growth weakness in the region has been heavily concentrated among the tourism-intensive economies. These countries grew on average by only 1.6% over 15 years, and only 0.8% in per capita terms. If you look at this chart over here, you see it. Look at the tourism economies here. This is the emerging markets, and this is the commodity exporters. Why this weak growth? If we do a simple decomposition of the factors underpinning growth and extract from the inputs of capital and labor, we notice that for the Caribbean tourism-intensive economies, total factor productivity is negative. What does that mean? Total factor productivity relates to issues like technology, its adaptation, and assimilation. The commodity exporters, somewhat better, but look at the total factor productivity of non-Caribbean emerging market developing countries, driven by Asia mainly, but it's not exclusively to Asia. There are small countries in here too, like Mauritius and so on. Let us now do a diagnostic, because that's where we are logically going, as to why weak growth and what factors contribute to the region's modern economic performance. An overall assessment will tell us that no single factor can be held responsible. Overall, persistent macroeconomic imbalances, particularly high fiscal deficits, and structural impediments to growth are the root cause of our malaise. I choose to capture it by saying the Caribbean has been stuck in a vicious cycle of high debt and low growth. Structural factors deeply embedded in the region's economies are leading to weak growth, and high debt is reinforcing the vicious circle. High debt dampens growth, weak growth drives up debt. Why elevated debt levels? Why are we the most indebted region in the Western Hemisphere? I offer a few simple explanations. First, rapid increases in debt are driven by large deficits in bad times, but not offset by savings in good times. We have a strong bias towards deficits. What do I mean by that? Countries struck by natural disasters or significant downturns in economic performance in the global economy tend to ramp up spending to mitigate these effects, and that produces high deficits and have driven up debt. But when economic conditions are more favorable, and external demand for tourism and the region's exports are more favorable, we do not generate fiscal savings. We continue to spend. Despite the high levels of debt that we have incurred right across the region, when you look at the growth performance over the last 20 years and lament its disappointment, you have to ask the question, did our elevated levels of debt really increase the capacity of our economies to produce competitive goods and services? Clearly, the answer is no. In addition to that, when we look at what is underpinning these large deficits, and we look on the revenue side, we have pervasive tax incentives. Estimates we have done at the IMF suggest that in the ECCU, Eastern Caribbean Currency Union countries, the granting of annual tax incentives, those based on legislation, tourism incentive acts, etc., and then those discretionary incentives based entirely by the decision of the minister, they have led to revenue losses between 4 to 9% of GDP. We have significantly undermined our revenue base. In many ways, the granting of tax incentives has been seen as a simple panacea to overcome the widespread distortions and inefficiencies in the countries. That is, we have provided a solution, but we haven't tackled the problem. In Mauritius, about 2 or 3 years ago, the parliament decided to remove from the authority of the minister the ability to grant tax incentives. Tax incentives, as part of the annual fiscal reporting, must be reported transparently, and all incentives granted reported in the parliament. I suggest there's a lesson there. But it's not only the revenue side of the ledger. Weak expenditure controls. And here I want to reference the significant fiscal risks of state-owned enterprises. You know, when we look at the region's public finances, and we look at the government's, central government's public finances, and you say the wage bill is 8% of GDP, emerging markets is more 4 to 5%, you may be tempted to think that the wage bill is not big. But when you extend it beyond the central government to the non-financial public sector, the wage bill can reach 20% of GDP. We have built up a very large state. And what has happened, it's become expensive, it's become costly, and we don't have the growth rates and associated revenue streams to maintain it. And a major question emerging, has it been supportive of growth and development? Has the expenditure generated a rate of return to the economy? Let's look more closely at what has happened. And we ask the question, why debt? High debt. If you look at this chart, post the crisis, between commodity exporters on this side and tourism intensive on that side, what we try to do here is to decompose the accumulation of debt and ask ourselves, what's driving it up? If you look in 2006-11, first of all, the overall story is both these species of economies had different experiences between 2006 and 2016, but ended up in the same place. If you look at this 2006-11 for the tourism intensive, and you ask what is contributing to the debt, you would see it's this yellow figure, which is real interest. So before the onset of the crisis, tourism intensive economies already had very large debt service payments, which points to the fact that they accumulated debt sharply pre the crisis. A colleague of mine, Sumiko Ogawa, and myself looked into this matter some time ago and asked ourselves why elevated debt levels pre-crisis. And what we found was that natural disasters, not surprisingly, was a significant component. But equally important was a sharp accumulation of government-guaranteed debt in support of state-owned enterprises. Now, since 2011, there has been a somewhat improvement for tourism intensive. Interest payments continue to be a negative, but higher growth combined with some spending restraint has reduced debt in these economies by about 3.6 percentage points. During the immediate post-crisis period of 2006 to 2011, the debt of the tourism-intensive group of countries went up by 9.3% of GDP. And in 2011 to 16, they unwound about 3.6% of GDP. That doesn't mean that their debt is low or sustainable. It just means that they were able to restrain the growth in their debt. What about the commodity exporters? If we look here in 2006-11, they enjoyed a significant drop-off in debt by about 11% of GDP, driven by strong growth and primary fiscal surpluses. If we recall the crisis and the immediate aftermath of the crisis, the advanced economies were contracting sharply, but the emerging markets were growing very well, very quickly too. Growth rates in China were topping 8-9%. Africa was growing at 5%, Latin America at 4%. because the world was experiencing a significant boom in commodity prices, driven by the rapid increasing demand for commodities to feed China's industrialization, mainly, and most of Asia. So you had a disconnect between the advanced economies and emerging developing countries. Therefore, that induced stronger growth in Africa, and it also induced stronger growth in the commodity exporters in the Caribbean. However, as we moved into 2011 and further, the commodity boom began to taper off, and commodity prices began to move towards trend. Not surprisingly, you see primary deficits jumped up here. This resulted in higher budget deficits and propelled debt to increase by an average of 20% of GDP between 2011 and 2016. In both cases, tourism intensive and commodity exporters, changing global conditions resulted in bad fiscal times that produced high deficits and rising debt. Neither species of economy built fiscal savings or buffers so that put them in a position to mitigate shocks they may face, natural disaster or economic. There was no fiscal space. And that is the ultimate tragedy of high debt. When you are paying wages and debt service payments, and out of every dollar of fiscal revenue, you have about 20 cents left, you have no fiscal space. And we will discuss the debilitating effects that that has had on the Caribbean's growth potential. You have no fiscal space, but you have no resilience. If you don't have fiscal savings, and we have been having natural disasters here for centuries, if you don't have fiscal savings in the immediate aftermath of a disaster, you cannot meet the immediate needs of disaster settlement. The longer term costs of reconstruction, you can do through some debt financing. But we need buffers so that we don't respond to shocks by elevating debt. Again, natural disasters are macro-critical. They have a massive economic and human cost. A colleague of mine at the IMF, Sebastian Acevedo, analyzed the cumulative effect on real GDP of an average hurricane after 7 years it's impacted a Caribbean country. We lose about 4.4% of GDP after 7 years of the impact of a hurricane. The macro impacts of these things last for a generation or longer. Smaller states, other small states, 2.5%. We're not the only small states that get hurricanes. The world, 0.9. So you see how these things, these natural disasters, have more profound effects on the Caribbean than even other small states. More importantly, huge reconstruction costs associated rehabilitation post-natural disasters means that countries are not in a position to meet other development objectives related to education, social sectors, and other important spending. This is becoming a more acute problem with the onset of climate change effects. When you look at it, the natural disaster risk is getting more acute. The damages are larger, and the storms are coming with higher frequency. If you see this, between 1950 and 2016, 324 of the 511 disasters that hit small states was in the Caribbean, 60 to 65% of them. Disasters are more frequent and costly in the Caribbean. If you look at damage, these are other states, small states, the Caribbean. If you look at frequency, both in damage and frequency, the Caribbean tops other small states and other countries. The Caribbean is now among the top 25 most vulnerable regions in the world in terms of disasters per capita or land area. Another factor that can underlay elevated debt levels and doesn't receive a lot of attention is the macro linkage between the financial sector and the public sector. Post the economic crisis, an economic recession, there was a gradual deterioration in the quality of bank assets, leaving countries with elevated levels of problem loans. The central bankers in the crowd see this every day. The share of non-performing loans in total loans, which was relatively low pre the crisis, rose to more than 10% by 2016 and at about 15% for many countries between 2000 2007 and 2016. The red dots indicate the highest level. You see, for some countries, it's relatively very high. You might ask, but why is this important? Non-performing loans were highest in the tourism-intensive economies. We should note that Caribbean financial systems are dominated by banks. We lack well-developed capital markets. Therefore, persistently high NPLs, elevated levels of risk, constrain the supply of credit to the private sector, negatively impacting economic activity. If you look at the growth of private sector credit from the banking sector to the private sector in the 10 years since the post-crisis, in some countries it's negative. And what we have now is large amounts of liquidity sitting down in the in banks, a lot of them finding their way into government debt, but not into productive investment. Let's look more closely at the evolution of the NPLs. Pre the crisis, credit growth was strong in most of the Caribbean countries, spurred by strong economic activity in tourism and the construction that went along with expanding tourism facilities, as well as favorable commodity prices for commodity exporters. But the rapid credit expansion between 2000 and 2006-07 also led to higher levels of public and private debt. The public we discussed before, this is the private now. The crisis led to drastic reductions in economic growth. This was through the channel largely of lower demand for tourism. This resulted in a contraction in tourism and construction sectors, sharp contraction. You lived through that in Barbados. Resulting in a sharp rise in unemployment and a loss of income for households and deteriorated corporate balance sheets, combining to produce rising non-performing loans. One of the issues about rising non-performing loans is that banks sometimes need recapitalization. We had the ABI Bank in Antigua and other state-owned banks in the region which required restructuring and recapitalization that led to significant increases in debt. That's what's underlying the high debt levels. Fiscal weakness, weak growth, natural disaster risks, and a linkage between the macro financial sectors. We did a review of 20 country characteristics relevant for medium-term growth and prosperity. And this reveals areas in which the Caribbean countries rank poorly. We looked at a wide range of doing business indicators, governance indicators, and we came up with this heat map. For each of the 20 indicators, the color of each cell indicates the relative ranking of a country group compared with others. So we have tourism intensive, Caribbean commodity exporter, and non-Caribbean small states. We had others, but I thought this would be the most relevant to share with you. A red cell indicates a less favorable ranking, and a green cell indicates a more favorable rank. For example, the greater the ease of doing business compared with other country groups, the greener the cell, and the higher the violent crime rate, the more red the cell color. When we look at the Caribbean, tourism intensive, immigration and skilled immigration, natural disasters, NPLs, trade tariffs and protection, all very red. For commodity exporters, immigration again, competitiveness, export diversification is really here. Commodity producers are concentrated in the energy sector and other commodity exports. When we look across at the doing business indicators, a lot of these come under the doing business indicator, you will see that only Jamaica has a favorable, but I won't even say good, doing business indicator in recent times. Look at where the rest of the Caribbean is concentrated. I will suggest to you that one of the principal causes underpinning these doing business indicators is an inefficient state. Complex economic regulations, poorly administered. Inefficient state-owned enterprises delivering high-cost, inefficient public services. The interface between private economic activity and public provision of services and the management of economic regulations is highly distortionary. Fiscal reconstruction that we spoke to earlier, minimizing the fiscal risks of state-owned enterprises, is not only important for long-term fiscal sustainability, but it is absolutely critical to improving our efficiency. Within the heat map, we didn't touch directly on this matter, but I want to put it to you, this is one of the key structural impediments we face. By any measure, energy costs are high and volatile in the Caribbean. We tried to put together, I did some work on this, and we produced a paper about 5 or 6 of us. And we looked, got some information. It is very difficult to get a database of electricity tariffs for the Caribbean. It takes painstaking patience, let me assure you. And we put this together, and you can see that our median tariff rates are well in excess of the United States. Our electricity is expensive. And then when we talk to the private sector, you see that electricity constrains the private sector activity. Look at where the Caribbean is. Addressing the energy needs and reducing energy costs is going to be a critical part of attempting to invigorate growth. This is a chart that I have to confess, when my colleagues did this work, surprised me. And I want to put it to you that this is a chart we must deliberate on. In the University of the West Indies, I grew up reading and thinking about the brain drain. And people used to argue that the brain drain is not a net development loss because remittances come back and provide financing and stability for foreign exchange earnings. The Caribbean countries stand out from their peers regarding outward migration of skilled human resources. The share of Caribbean nationals with a tertiary education, which we could call a proxy for high skills and knowledge, living abroad is 76%. We are exporting 3/4 of our human capital. When you combine that with what we said earlier about structural impediments, low rates of a highly inefficient state, you see that the core ingredients of nutritious growth are missing in the region. When we look at US data, it indicates that Caribbean migrants are well educated. Nearly half of the immigrants to the United States have at least a college education. This is a ratio comparable to the US population itself. In contrast, 1/4 of the immigrants, from the Latin American and Spanish Caribbean, DR and so on, in the United States have a college education, only 1/4. A study we then did at the IMF finds that the negative impact of immigration on real GDP growth through the brain drain outweighs the gains from remittances, although remittances support investment and education and foster commercial linkages. When we look to estimate this, you would see in the Caribbean the growth impact of the net effect of migration and remittances on long-term GDP growth 2003 to 2013 in the Caribbean ranges between -10% and maybe +1. There is no other region in this hemisphere that is remotely close. We are exporting our skills. I will emphasize that it should not be understated that remittances are an important source of foreign exchange and a key macroeconomic stabilizer for the region. However, the losses in human capital and the long-term growth effects outweigh those benefits. This is a matter that we have begun to pay even increasing attention to. The Caribbean has some of the highest violent crime rates in the world, with an average homicide rate of about 24 per 100,000 people in 2015. If you look here, this is where we are concentrated. I mean, the Central Americans are way above there, but this is where we are concentrated. The homicide rate in the Caribbean is more than 3 times the homicide rate in non-Caribbean small states. A study done by the Inter-American Development Bank in 2017 pointed out that crime impedes economic growth by discouraging tourism and business investment, weakening worker productivity, and importantly, diverting government spending from investment in health and education and productive infrastructure to security. It is estimated that direct crime-related costs, in the IDB study, it is estimated that direct crime-related costs amount to about 3.6% of GDP for the Caribbean. Crime has significant growth impacts. This chart shows that about 2% of GDP is government cost on crime. And I'm just using the Bahamas, there are four countries here. Another 2% of GDP is the private cost of crime. And this smaller amount is the social cost that the society as a whole pays for crime. This is a significant diversion of our resources. So we have high debt levels, deficit biases, rising and more devastating natural disasters, weaknesses in the financial sector, and significant structural impediments to growth. When you put it together, you see how I arrive at the vicious cycle. The macroeconomic impediments of weak fiscal positions and elevated levels of public debt are reinforcing the negative growth effects from the structural impediments. And the structural impediments are producing weak growth that is negatively impacting macroeconomic performance. It's self-reinforcing, and it's been going on for a long time. What the crisis did is perhaps bring it faster to the agenda. The issue now is, how do we break the vicious cycle of low growth and high debt? I don't pretend to have all the answers. But I think there's some thoughts that flow from the diagnostic. I gave this presentation in another part of the world, and they told me they didn't know that the IMF thought about these things. Crime and immigration and so on. Obviously, the fiscal performance and fiscal weakness tells you we must address the government's financial position. We did a table in 2016, and we said, what are the fiscal conditions of some of these countries, Trinidad, Barbados, Suriname, Guyana, non-Caribbean community, St. Lucia, you know, and other species of the countries here. What's the fiscal balance? What is the interest? What's the overall deficit? Then we said, if we take the primary balance in 2016 as the baseline fiscal performance, and then we derive the public, or the, sorry, the primary balance, that if we held it constant, all these countries would reach to a debt ratio of 60% of GDP in 10 years, 2026, an experiment. We then went over and we said, we took Trinidad and Tobago. Based on what we have discussed with the government, this is the adjustment that they intended to take. But to get to the 60% in 10 years, this is the additional adjustment that they would need. Well, not to frighten the Trinidadians, those numbers have improved somewhat. Look at Barbados. This is what the government said it intended to do, not what it was actually doing, you know. What it intended to do, you give them the benefit of the, they do this. This is the additional adjustment needed. Suriname benefited from the fact that they were in a program at the time, and so on. That has changed. But you get the point I'm making. For illustrative purposes, the region needs strong, front-loaded fiscal consolidation to reduce debt levels, to preserve stability. But it's not only a matter of making a one-step adjustment to a reach to a fiscal sustainability. And this is where the hard work is. We have to be able to sustain fiscal discipline. We are doing some work now on over 25 years looking at the periods of consolidation. And what we find is, even in the IMF program, periods in which we consolidate, achieve fiscal sustainability, and go back into fiscal excess. To come back to consolidate, achieve fiscal, to go back into fiscal excess. I am suggesting to you, we can no longer tolerate that. And this is where we need a fundamental shift in the policy paradigm. First, we need to strengthen our policy frameworks in institutional capacity. What does that mean? We too often continue to conduct budgets on the basis of an annual budget. We do not cast budgets in terms of a medium-term framework. We do not, in the main, set a long-term target of where we intend to, what we intend to achieve. The Eastern Caribbean Currency Union countries have said that the debt to GDP ratio should not exceed 60% by 2030. You can call that a long-term anchor. Flowing from that, you have to have a primary balance target that you achieve on an annual basis that will get you there. Flowing from that, you then have to see on the basis of the revenues that you can get, your projections for growth, where are the expenditure choices? What are the priorities? This imposes a certain level of discipline on you. But most importantly, it holds policymakers accountable for performance. So we cannot come up with frameworks with targets aside from the society. It must be inclusive of the society. Today, people say, on our advice, is establish explicit fiscal responsibility frameworks. Put it in law. Set up a fiscal rule that provides a long-term target, an operational target, but also allows escape clauses if you have to meet known shocks, like a natural disaster. That alone won't be enough. We need supporting fiscal institutions. The fiscal people will tell you should have a fiscal council, which is an independent group of stakeholders that would review, it's like the CBO, the Congressional Budget Office in the United States, that will review fiscal performance, make projections. It goes to the United States Congress at the same time the president is producing the budget. So you have a fiscal council made up of independent stakeholders that provide an evaluation of the authorities and policymakers' performance relative to the targets they set themselves. Professor Danny Roderick at Harvard University says what small countries and developing countries need are institutions of consensus building. We have them in the Caribbean. Social partnership in Barbados, the Economic Policy Oversight Committee in Jamaica, similar arrangements in Grenada, and so on and so on. These institutional arrangements must become the focal points for policy dialogue, the design and implementation of economic policy. They must be inclusive. The only way you can get sustained reform is through ownership. People, the society, must have ownership of its economic and policy framework. It must be inclusive. It's likely to be contentious, but it is only through a sustained and effective process of dialogue that you can get there. Policy making that is not inclusive can have unintended consequences. In addition to that, to produce the fiscal outcomes, public financial management systems need to improve. I won't go into this, there's a lot of technicalities about cash management and so on, but you need additional aspects of the financial management of the central government to improve. We are back again on restructuring state-owned enterprises, including and establishing financial oversight and management of state-owned enterprises. Throughout the region, state-owned enterprises, in the main, don't provide timely audited financial statements. Some haven't done for years. The state is not entirely clear what is the financial condition of a state-owned enterprise, except when you see the budget cycle is coming to an end, and then all of a sudden you see in the parliament large requests for transfers to address the financial problems of these state-owned enterprises. That is not discipline, that is indiscipline. We also need transparent fiscal reporting. You are providing tax incentives, you must report on your tax expenditures. What you intend to provide, and at the end of the fiscal year, did you exceed, or did you meet that, or did you fall below? Transparency brings accountability. Accountability can bring discipline. It's not a linear relationship, but it can result in that. Achieving a new framework like this is going to shift the paradigm of how we do business. You know, the emerging market developing economies, they went to inflation targeting. They have flexible exchange rates. So they try to ensure that inflation, the annual inflation rate falls within a very narrow band. And I remember the former central bank governor of Brazil, at the time Lula took over, I was reading, at the time Lula took over Brazil many years ago, and they set up the inflation target. You know, Brazil in the 90s had runaway hypercurrencies, hyperinflation, total disorder. And I remember him saying that when they set up the inflation targeting regime, it means that the fiscal authority has a responsibility to help the central bank achieve the inflation target. And they missed the target the first three times they reported on it. But the benefit was they had to explain why they missed the target. And they had to come up with what the remedial measures are. It's the same thing I'm saying here. In designing economic policy within our social public institutions, we have to agree on what the targets are. We have to agree what the framework is. When we don't meet the targets, why did we miss the targets? And what are the remedial measures we are going to take? Looking at natural disasters, this lowers debt risk, mitigating risk. We talked about that, putting these, providing for annual fiscal savings in our budget to go into a savings account for a resilience fund. You can call it whatever you want, but the resilience fund is topical, so that when you are impacted by natural disasters, you are able to respond appropriately. At least you have a basis to respond appropriately. Mitigating the risk to debt distress. We have to focus on building resilient infrastructure, build risk marks, early warning systems, enforcing land use and zoning rules. We cannot treat these things lightly. Climate change is not going to reverse itself. It's a real issue we face, and that's our 21st century challenge to remain viable and have long-run growth prospects that will raise the living standards of our people. Our response to natural disasters tends to be ex post, after the disasters occurred. It's not ex ante. The World Bank produced a table that shows for a variety of disasters, earthquakes, floods, tropical storms. This is the break-even point or the cost-benefit ratio break-even point for investments prior to disaster to mitigate its effects. Despite that, preparing for disasters are more cost-effective than responding after the fact. But countries don't do that. Countries come perennially underinvest in risk reduction and prevention. Why? Why do they do that? Policies to build resilience are based on three pillars. Emergency response. We've done that. CIDEMA, national agencies coordinating response in the immediate aftermath of a natural disaster. Financial protection. Action to mitigate financial risks. We have created the Caribbean Catastrophic Risk Insurance Facility, CRIF, that is supported by the countries, by the donors, and international financial institutions, against to provide parametric insurance against natural disasters. Three, structural protection. Measures to increase the resilience of public infrastructure and key economic sectors to natural disasters and climate change. We are falling significantly below what is required. Investment in resilient infrastructure does not seem to have been prioritized. But if you think about it, you don't have any fiscal space. If you try to invest, you're going to accumulate more and more debt. So when people say that high debt is not important, you have to wonder. Limited fiscal space, domestic fiscal resources contribute to underinvestment in resilience. Lack of private financing. Climate change adaptation projects normally do not attract private finance for their low profitability. And there's insufficient international financing. Despite increases in recent years, climate finance for adaptation is falling short of needs. So we need to have a fiscal framework that allows us to mitigate the negative effects of climate change over this century. We also need to find ways of incentivizing the private market to finance that for the private sector and others. And we need to have a stronger commitment working with the international community. Let's move on. How do we deal with NPLs? We did a survey of what banks' views on the major obstacles to resolving the NPLs and bringing them down, and what the authorities, our colleagues in the central bank community, feel. In most cases, macro policies to support stronger growth will reduce NPLs, and that's obvious, we discussed that. But there are significant improved strategies needed to address the structural bottlenecks to the resolution of loans. I won't go into a lot of this because this is more specific to the central banking and regulating community. They know it better than I do anyway. Suffice it to say, We have some key weaknesses. Banks should adopt prudent loan recognition and provisioning practices and apply appropriate real estate valuation standards to improve collateral valuation. A lot of the NPLs is related to real estate, either commercial or private. But there's a disconnect, an information gap between buyers and sellers on what is the appropriate valuation of these assets. And therefore, the market is, in many cases, not able to clear. Obviously, sellers over-optimistic on what the value is, buyers looking at trends in the market, less so. Policies could focus on removing these information gaps that hinder the appropriate pricing of risk, collateral violation, and narrowing of large gaps between buyers and sellers. Developing markets for distressed assets is also another need. Let us now look at these structural impediments. If we look at energy, you will see that the world on average relies on petroleum for about 40% of its energy needs. Look at the Caribbean. It relies on petroleum for about 86% of its energy needs. We are probably the most petroleum-dependent region in the world. My colleagues on the Jamaica team shared this chart with me recently. In 2015, 94% of Jamaica's energy needs were coming from petroleum. By 2016, they began to break in to liquefied natural gas. Two wind plants came on board, a biomass plant on board, renewables expanded. 2019-20, this is going to come from here to there. LNG energy uses is going to expand considerably in Jamaica, as is renewables. These two, particularly this one, is a considerably cheaper energy source than petroleum. What does this mean? The diversification of your energy matrix. To be fair, countries have been moving in this direction, putting in place revisions to power purchase agreements, etc., to incentivize the use of renewable energies. There's not a lot of discussion in the public space about it. I think your Mr. Busy Williams here has been talking about this and talking about renewable energies. But this is a critical challenge. Remember, we depend on a hotel industry. And the establishment, sorry, a tourism industry. And the establishment in the tourism industry is a hotel, where air conditioning is a vital ingredient. Energy costs are about 40% of running a hotel, of which the largest share is air conditioning. Getting a cheaper source of energy is one thing, which is what this speaks to. But you could also adopt energy-saving technologies. Retrofit your air conditioning plants, retrofit your lighting. In the United States, the energy supplier I have sends me every month an energy report on my usage. What is my usage relative to people in the county, residents in the county I live and to the state I live, and recommendations on how you can reduce usage. You can ask them to come and do an energy audit for you. They will go through your house and give you recommendations. This is an area that we have to seriously tackle. I can't say a lot on this, to be honest. What we know is more work is required to assess the effects of existing public policies and crime prevention programs in the Caribbean. As spelled out in the IDB study, a greater emphasis on prevention alongside the suppression of crime is warranted. Prevention elements should be integrated into social programs in health and education, especially among the youth population, notably the young males. The study noted that there are some promising initiatives in some countries where they have sought to adopt programs that were successful in other jurisdictions. For example, in Trinidad and Tobago, they have sought to adopt Chicago's ceasefire program, which reduces violent crime through prevention and community mobilization strategies, crime mediators from the community to mediate disputes between opposing gangs. But you can see here, we have focused our resources here. I mean, Trinidad is spending about 12% of government expenditure on security, you know. That's a large amount. St. Lucia, 10%. There's nowhere that security expenditure aimed at suppressing crime is not significant. And that's a number, we took a snapshot here, but that's a number that's growing as a share of government expenditure. There is a regional dimension to this. As cynical as people are about regional integration, facts are stubborn things. What they say, you're entitled to your own opinion, but not your own facts. The case for deeper economic integration remains strong and very valid. You have to overcome the constraints of small size. We need to recognize that we are small, small markets, small populations, and we. But what is going to define us is how efficiently and effectively we integrate not only with ourselves, but with the rest of the world. All the empirical studies suggest that Caribbean integration process has been successful in fostering some intra-regional trade, but that at the same time has plateaued in recent years. It is not growing. The benefits of integration, people argue, has been constrained by implementation deficit. The CARICOM single market and economy agenda is characterized by persistent delay and non-implementation of initiatives. That's for a different discourse. What I would say to you is that we are working, a group of us are now working on integration, which we will produce probably in a book next year, taking a look at Caribbean integration. And one of the things we asked ourselves, in the ideal world, where this group of countries did in fact implement all the policies or the core policies of the CSME, particularly as it relates to the movement of labor and capital, and we put that in a modeling framework, in the ideal world, what are the potential benefits from that? The growth gains are not modest. There are large potential gains from the completion of the CSME agenda, particularly from removing or reducing restrictions on services and factors of production. Businesses find it difficult to scale up their business from one island to another. Person opens a business here, say a Barbadian opens a restaurant. He or she does very well. He wants to open it in Trinidad or in St. Lucia. Getting into the market there to do the restaurant, you run into all kinds of barriers. A foreign investor coming from the United States seeking to put up the same restaurant runs into the same barriers. The business environment is inhospitable to whoever you are, whether you are in the Caribbean or outside the Caribbean. The inefficient management and bureaucratic delay of economic regulations and delivery of public services is bedeviling private investment by region and outside. When you look at the region, we have had a variety of efforts at public sector reform. When you look in your day-to-day business that you conduct with the state, you talk to people on the basis of an iPhone. You look at movies, you communicate with friends, you can check your bank account, a variety of personal transactions on the basis of an iPhone. You are using more and more technology, video as well as audio. The state is stuck in the technology of the 60s. It's paper-based, it's slow, it's highly labor-intensive. Getting a transaction done with the state as simple as a driver's license can be extremely tedious. Business registration, contract enforcement, the courts, while ethical, are inefficient. The core functions of the state to support a growing economy are far too inefficient. One of the things we are doing in this study is at looking at the interface between improving doing business conditions and setting a basis for stronger integration. Because right now, we are trying to integrate a group of very inefficient places. You add them up, you get one big inefficient place. Regional integration will move forward when national policy reform becomes more sustained and more focused. I have a reason why I am addressing these structural impediments in the exhaustive way that I'm doing. First of all, you think I'm coming from the IMF, it's all fiscal balances and austerity programs. Policymakers can never take their focus away from the question of growth. You have to constantly focus on what is needed to achieve stronger and more inclusive growth. Growth doesn't always mean happiness, but you can start there. We have not been focused. We have had a variety of studies. Caribbean Growth Forum, multilateral institutions, and central banks, Caribbean Development Bank have produced a variety of studies. But where do we discuss our reform effort for growth and address these questions I'm saying here? You have to address macro and fiscal stability and bring down debt. But you also have to tackle growth. It's interlocking. We have to move from a vicious cycle of weak growth and high debt to a virtuous cycle of high growth and low debt. So it means we can't silo reforms. It must be integrated. We then said, if the region did become successful in tackling some of these structural impediments, can we say what the growth dividend, quote, to be, or growth benefit would be? In the IMF, we did some analytical work that attempted to simulate this proposition. We took where the individual countries were in some of these indicators like human capital, debt, lower crime. You remember the 20 characteristics in the heat map? And we said, if these countries, which are the lower half and some in lower third, in the rankings on these questions, on these policy issues, if these countries were to move from there to the top decile of small states, in other words, makes significant improvement in these policy-related areas, can we say what the growth payoff might be? We estimated some growth equations with some of these things. In the book that we have, Unleashing Growth and Strengthening Resilience, it's in there for those of you who may be interested. It's estimated that the illustrative growth gains are in the range of 1 to 3 percentage points per year. It's not insignificant. The policy priorities differ by country. For Jamaica, it is about less debt and lower crime. For Barbados, is it about less debt and the greater ease of doing business? For St. Kitts, it's about lower disaster damage and a greater ease of doing business, and surprisingly, lower crime. St. Kitts crime rates will surprise you. So it's a common group of factors, but their importance varies across the region. What I want to point out, and this is where the discipline comes in, none of these reforms are going to generate growth overnight. As the governor says in cricket parlance, it's not a T20, it's a test match. And that's why the institutional arrangements for policy making and implementation is as or more important than the policy design itself. If you don't have a strong institutional arrangement for policy designs and implementation that's inclusive, you are subject to a lot of reversals. You do something today, and tomorrow it gets reversed. Stop and go is very debilitating because you build no credibility. When you tell investors who have to think 7 to 10 years down the road, when you tell skilled people or you tell workers, this is where the country is going, these are where the choices are, and then you shift course, and it's non-transparent where you shift course, everybody gets frustrated, everybody gets cynical. I'm not saying it's a linear process. There are mistakes. Countries make them. They learn from them. But it is the dialogue that is important. Policymakers must embrace their countries in the dialogue. I did a study with Kevin Greenidge on the impact of structural reforms on growth in the Caribbean. It reinforces that. It's positive for growth, but it's over the long term. The important lesson, as I said, is a reform effort must be sustained and not ad hoc. 2 points to raise. All the policy priorities identified will help strengthen the ease of doing business in the Caribbean. The very small scale of most Caribbean economies makes removing barriers for business operating across these economies to achieve economies of scale particularly important. Improves business environments with more efficient service delivery by the public sector, efficient and supportive economic regulations will continue to support deeper economic integration. More efficient national economies are supportive of private investment. The issue of immigration, greater human capital, to which we deferred. A comprehensive strategy is needed to create an environment that encourages skilled people to stay and provides incentives for return migration. But let's be honest, sitting so close to the most dynamic economy and largest economy in the world and most advanced is always going to have a pulling sound for skilled labor. And the studies on globalization show you that some of the largest beneficiaries of a more integrated world have been skilled people. What we find is that to retain highly skilled workers, you must continue to invest in upgrading the processes and technologies in your education and learning institutions. You have to invest substantially in education. Building up cadres of skilled people. While you are doing that, you have to create economic opportunity. It's a very self-reinforcing set of things. People tend to migrate to go and work in their chosen profession alongside other professionals in strong institutions. It's not simply an economic calculation. People tend to leave because they are frustrated in the pursuit of their skills. This is a signal failure of regional integration. The integrated labor market is supposed to help us overcome this. But the inefficient bureaucracy that is in government, that supervises the integrated labor market, the regional movement of labor, is a disincentive. I know people that tell me the CARICOM skills certificate can get you, take you 5-6 months. We must remember, you know, to the north of us, we have populations that are aging. Birth rates are low. They will need, they're going to merit-based immigration systems. They're going to need our skills. I have a couple of other issues, and I want to address one before closing. This is the immediate thing that is well known to central bankers and people in the financial sector, which is the risk to loss of corresponding banking relationships. Relationships with other banks that allows us to carry out a variety of transactions. Post the crisis, the regulations around this changed, and prudential regulations changed, and the cost of compliance with those regulations went up, and risk to corresponding banker relations rose. Concerns about some of the citizenship by investment programs, the quality of our anti-money laundering frameworks enhanced some of those risks. If you look at this chart, it is very dense, but if you look at the Caribbean here, you would see how ours were declining. We were losing the number of counterparty countries very rapidly. What we can say now is that over 2016-17, while the Caribbean has had some of the largest CBR declines, it seems to have stabilized. But the reform effort has to be sustained. This is a new risk that we face. Those who want to talk about the citizenship by investment programs that common to the ECCU countries, we can pick it up, but I don't want to ramble on for much longer. What I can say the key takeaways are, is that macro stability is necessary, but it's not sufficient. We need fiscal bubbles to shock absorbers, strengthen our macro fundamentals, strengthen our financial sector. Structural reforms are key to achieving strong and sustained growth, and we address structural impediments, requires a multi-pronged approach. We have much work to do, but I visit to you, we have a lot more to do on the structural side than we have to do on the macro fiscal side. Getting the right institutional arrangements for policy that are inclusive and consensus building and that strengthen discipline in the management of our economic affairs is really the only way out of the vicious cycle of high debt and low growth. I hope the region can grasp the challenge. Thank you very much.
We want to beg Arnold's indulgence a bit longer to provide you with the opportunity to pose any questions or comments that you may have.
Hi, good evening, everyone. My name is Khalil Bryan. I have a startup company focused in transportation technology. And you, Dr. McIntyre, that's a fantastic presentation. You spoke about how we start to use data to start to make some decisions, because we're moving into, certainly we have moved into an age where the speed of decision making needs to be relevant to the information that's provided. As you continue to talk with various governments and central bankers and people throughout the region, how has their response to that message been, and how have you started to see us, how can you see us moving in that direction a lot more speedily than we are now? Thank you.
Good point. The what is always harder than what to do. I think colleagues here are aware, not raising any issues they're not aware of. What we can do is usefully look at country examples. I mean, if you look at a place like Estonia, that is about 1.9, 1.6 million people coming out of the collapse of the Soviet Union into the unification of Europe. They took the decision to have a digitized society. And I can tell you their computer penetration was lower than ours, and their human resource endowments was lower than ours. You look at Mauritius, what they have done in their public sector. People can sit on their phones, on their laptops, pay their taxes, their car insurance, not their car insurance, their car registration, a number of public transactions through IT. In Estonia, you can register a business in 16 minutes, literally. They have an integrated database that allows you to do that. My colleague, Therese Turner-Jones, from the Inter-American Development Bank, has looked very deeply at the case of Estonia. You see, you have to fundamentally ask yourself, as technology evolves, how do small countries keep up? And the question is, the state has not adapted and assimilated technology. Until we get serious and focus on a more efficient, cost-effective state, it's going to be a drag on our economic transactions. You know, as a young economist at Cave Hill, I used to think, and I did my PhD thesis on this, that export competitiveness was our challenge. How do we deal with that? I went off studying what the Asians did, what this did, what that did, and I came up with a perspective on it. But I missed what Sir Arthur Lewis saw many, many years ago. Government has a role in economic development. It should be facilitating, but to be facilitating, it has to be efficient. An inefficient government cannot be facilitating. And small countries have a lot of pressure on them to produce efficient economic systems. What we have seen is that we stood still, and we see we are in reverse. Other small countries have gone past us. Even this issue of climate and natural disaster risk, when you see what the Pacific Island countries are doing between themselves to strengthen their resilience, it will tell you. So a commitment to digitization and other forms of use of information technology is critical. And we are better placed than most because we have a lot of skilled people and well-educated people. There's no reason we should not do it.
Excellent presentation tonight. Sorry, my name is Kimar Stewart. And recently I saw that Jamaica is experiencing very, very high growth rates on the stock exchange. So upon further research, I noticed that they signed on to the Sustainable Stock Exchange Initiative, where they focus on environmental issues, social and governance issues within regulation of financial companies and what's not. So my question is, with the rigidness of our local stock exchange, if we follow an initiative such as Jamaica and also look at creating smaller pockets of economic activity within the stock exchange, because you made mention of privatizations. So can our local stock exchange play a role in the privatization through shares, say possibly like in transport board or what's not? Basically, that would provide an intermediary for persons who may not be too knowledgeable within the area, where they could access the stock exchange for information. So do you see that as a plausible way going forward for us?
I have to admit, I don't know about the initiative in Jamaica you're speaking. But I will say this, that you can increase a shareholding democracy by allowing public enterprises and other enterprises to issue, to raise equity in a stock exchange. The central bank governors here and other parts of the CARICOM apparatus have been working on a long time for the integrated stock exchange and integrated capital markets and so on. That can play a role. What I would say, and obviously positive benefits to it, what I would say, before you can get there, you first have to address the enterprises. Some of these enterprises we just have to close. Because when we analyzed what drove up the debt, you remember we talked about government guaranteed debt? What we also discovered is that when many governments want to spend money, they either do it off budget or they create a state enterprise to do it. So long after they've spent the money, the enterprise remains, but its mandate is unclear. So I think the restructuring of the enterprises is where we should focus.
Back in 2006-07, the government had possibly a contingent liability figure of over $4 billion in loans to state-owned enterprises. And in the Auditor General's reports, none of these loans were repaid or, you know? So my suggestion would be to look at legislation to be able to cap contingent liabilities so that governments cannot basically open a state-owned enterprise and decide to pad it with loans at the expense of the public, because it's written in law in Barbados that these contingent liabilities are to be paid back by the taxpayers.
Well, that's true. Taxpayers always pay for everything, you know. But more seriously, look, you raise very valid points, but that's why I speak to the institutional arrangements, because that's where you need to reach agreement how you address your problems. Do we need a law? What is the law? What is the cap? And then you're transparent about it, and now you're accountable, right? So I agree with you. A significant challenge for all Caribbean countries is this issue of financial discipline in the management of the state and in the management of these enterprises. Individual societies will decide what enterprises they want to keep, whether they're going to charge user service charges to access these services. In many of our countries, you don't think we should pay for anything. Somebody mentioned to me the other day in a discussion that some of the Caribbean countries have doubled their per capita income, but they're still not paying for social services. So these are the choices you have to make as well.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Congratulations to the presenter. His lecture was very inspiring, so congratulations. I cannot say a question, but a comment, really a comment. I have an issue, the whole issue about growth. Growth is not for rocks. Growth is for people. You understand? So there is a danger. Whatever you presented is like you stop halfway or necessary condition. Because you can have you solve the debt problem, you have some growth, but still the people are suffering. That's why you said yourself, or maybe in the passing, this issue of inclusive growth. I think we have to focus more on inclusive growth, Because if you look, for example, the African country, you alluded to that. For, if you take some even my country, the DRC, we are the bottom, but for maybe 5 or 6 years, we have high growth, 4, 5, 6%, but for me, it's really, yes, it's necessary condition, but it's irrelevant. People are still poor there. So you have, there is a danger. I'm sorry, but basically, it's good for the politician when they say, I remember our premier will come. Well, we are fine. The growth is 6%, but it's irrelevant for the people's point of view. It's irrelevant. So is it dangerous? I mean, we have to be careful with this speech. But I think we cannot stop just this growth. I think we have to build a bridge with inclusive growth. You understand? Otherwise, I mean, yes. I'm having a problem with that. So it's just a comment.
No, it's an extremely important point. I deliberated on the issue of how I treat inequality. Because even in growing countries, there's rising inequality. There's rising inequality between countries and within countries. In the United States, for example. In the United Kingdom. In Latin America. And we do have a very strong grain of research in the fund on this issue of growth and inequality. And you're correct. You want growth that is lifting people's standard of living and improving the individual. In an indirect way, I address that through this question of sustained investment in education and human resources and that kind of thing. But your point is well made. You can focus at growth, but you can also have growth with inequality. Your point is well made. But you'd appreciate I also have to have a tractable lecture too that I have.
Okay, I think we have one more question in the back.
Dr. McIntyre, Noel Lynch, good evening. Commendations on a very thought-provoking presentation. I didn't get a full picture, though, of where you stood on the issues of incentives for investment, particularly in the tourism sector. I've always felt that, I'll try to craft it into a question, but a comment first. I've always thought that there was no magic about incentives in terms of encouraging investment. Because I don't think most people even know about the incentives when they first look at a country for investment. The two things that I think that matter most to them is the ease of doing business and profitability. But then everyone else around you is offering incentives. And therefore there is huge competition. And therefore what do we do in a situation where everybody else is offering incentives? Because once they start to look at your jurisdiction and they get involved, then they actually, that accelerates their interest in what you want to do. The second thing is this, if we never, with regards to the brain drain that you spoke about, we have a lot of citizens, first, second, third generation Barbadians and Caribbean people in developed countries. Where they're concerned, I don't necessarily think that you have to have them resident in your country because we're never going to be able to attract, to keep most of them. But we live in an age in which we can attract the skills base of first, second, and third generation Caribbean people to contribute to our development in ways in which we've never done. Nobody has a database of Caribbean people, for example, in living in the United States, and a skill set that we can apply to work plans to say that these people can contribute to us. What we've always looked towards, in my opinion, is issues of remittances, issues of buying a piece of the rock, investing in government paper. But nobody has ever said, where do we have a cadre of Caribbean people resident in developed jurisdictions that can actually contribute to us if we found a way to match skills and professions with a work plan for development in our region? I'd like to hear your comments.
No, that's two good points. On the last one, on immigration, you're absolutely right. As I said, countries have to think about how best to go about this. And also, you can't attract everybody back. That's very difficult to do. And also, that you're right, you can use information technology to link people up and so on. There's no problem with that. But when you look at the policy discourse that we have around economic policy, it's all about the budget. We are not spending as much effort and intellectual resources and time studying how to address the structural impediments to growth. We don't have policy frameworks for dealing with these individual issues that are well understood by our societies, and we can measure progress against what we are trying to do. So I agree with you on immigration. On the question of tax incentives, Jamaica and Grenada have changed their tax incentive regimes, and they have now codified them in their laws. So the days of long tax holidays are over. You get 7 years, and then you can apply for investment allowances or depreciation allowances or tax credits or some combination. There's a study done by the Chicago Business School that shows that tax incentives have largely been highly wasteful across the world. But then you make the point, you can say that, but other countries are doing it. So investors look at one. Well, this is a collective action problem. And all it does is all of us race to the bottom, just at different speeds. Because the guy wants 25% here, he wants 20% here, and then everybody tries to outdo each other. We see similar signs now emerging in the countries competing with the citizenship by investment programs. They're all dropping the costs. This is wasteful competition. And in these institutions where policy is made, this is where we have to tell governments that. This is wasteful competition. And the private sector needs to say the same. Now I notice everybody wants to level the playing field by having a level set of fiscal incentives. But the losses of revenue are very substantial. You can have some incentive regime, I don't say get rid of them. And both Jamaica, and particularly, both Grenada and Jamaica, and particularly Jamaica, is getting FDI. It's not stopping them from getting FDI. You know, you can grant generous fiscal incentives, but the rest of your bureaucracy is highly inefficient, you're still not going to get the investment. It's not a panacea for your other weaknesses. Thank you very much.